Well, my master plan is Aoide. I ultimately do want to run some of the Fox Guild, but I want to do it for a just reason. They're too shady, I don't like the way they're doing things, and they don't give an F about the rest of us. My group's really cool. I have conflict of interest with Aldrin, though. Aldrin's a little too silly for my taste, but so am I. I'm a bard. I like performing. But he's an interesting holy man. But so is my monk. But we work well together because I think we all have an ambition that is either slightly selfish, we're aware that it's selfish, but we actually care about each other. So it's a fun. I think that's how it works together. I don't think I'd be hanging out with people of this caliber besides Delron if we didn't work together. First time I fell in love with role-playing games was actually when I met my husband. I've always been a big fan of just role-playing in general. I was the child that was playing imaginary and pretend until, Lord knows, until high school and writing stories. And I used to role-play a lot online forums. And then he decided, we had a friend, he's like, hey, let's all play D&D together. And so me and my husband joined a group, and I fell in love with it ever since. I think my husband brought it up when he had a conversation with our producer, Jesus, and then Andrew, and they wanted to do this big project. He got really excited because he wanted to write for it. He joked around saying, I don't want to do this without you. It took a little effort because though I can be extroverted, I'm kind of an introvert, so a lot of stuff that takes up my energy and time, I'm like, I don't know, very hasty about it. But he's like, no, I want you to be part of it, and so I joined in, and I've liked it ever since. That's how I first heard from it. It's interesting because I've always been the type of person that I kind of like, I don't want to use the word independence, but I guess it is independence. I like that we both have our own mutual things that we like and get used to. So being in something like this, you don't want like the personal partnership to get in the way. You don't want to be like, well, I told you and you have to listen to me because I'm your wife. Nothing like that. So it's unique having to gauge when to just be a professional and then when to be his wife. Obviously, I do err on the side of the professional more, but you do kind of have like that clash. You don't want to take things personal. I don't want to ever offend him if I don't like a storyline or something like that, so you just kind of have to walk that nice line. The concept of vicious mockery, to the best that I know of, the concept is just a group of friends creating this world. It's in a unique world compared to any of the other D&D. We're not using a pre-written story. It's a story that keeps getting written as it goes on between himself and our writer friend, Mike Buckley. And it was this kind of, I don't want to say it's similar to like Geek and Sundry's component. I think it's more unique where we're real people. We're trying to entertain, it's fun, and we're building this world together. And it's a unique world. It's not like every other D&D, and it's fun. I think that the overall concept is something presenting something fun to people who have never done it before. So my Vicious Mockery character is, I play Aoide. She is a bard tiefling. The backstory that I have for her is she comes from the main city that we all kind of met up. She is a scoundrel. She's lived on the streets, mostly because there's no one else like her. When you see big horns, you think devils, and we're not going to touch them. You're either cursed or some unique creature that we don't want to mess with. In doing so, she's kind of attached herself to being, playing her bard part, kind of being mischievous, but doing it for a cause. The cause being the orphanage that she kind of rooted herself in. And through that same orphanage is how she met our monk friend, Delron. And so with him, they kind of just worked the streets, helped provide for it. And it wasn't until meeting the rest of the group that she pulled more of what she wanted to do into the landscape, and that was trying to be part of a guild. Originally, it was to get her to be part of the Rogues Guild, the Foxes, and slowly her trust. She didn't have trust in them anyways, but she's kind of lost trust as the story is going on because she knows they've been doing these really shady things that have been affecting the aspect of the story. It was more, the idea of colors was more to kind of help identify who played what character when we kind of went in the round table of where we're sitting and how we do things. Ultimately, I chose blue because it's actually my favorite color. In the storyline, she's originally supposed to, my character is supposed to have a blue pendant. That's what she carries with her. That's the only thing she knows about her past. As we've played, I've noticed a lot of the stuff that I bring the color into has been mostly like my dice. My hair now currently has traces of blue. If not, I usually wear like blue lipsticks because those are what you mostly see is the face. And so that's the easiest thing to have instead of like some pendant or piece of jewelry. I have to have my blue dice. I for sure, all my dice have to be blue. I have two sets of gravity dice that are my favorite. They're D6s, so I don't get to use them often until I actually start battling. And the other thing is I have to have some form of blue on me. It's usually makeup. I go with the lipstick, or if I can't do the lipstick or it looks odd, I tend to do the eyeshadow. Those are my things. As a group, though, because of how I sit next to Audrin, which is Andrew's character. We always have to have the red vines and gummies. I think as you go through our series, you'll notice at some point the camera will turn on us and either one of us has something in our mouth because it's a gummy, it's a red vine. At one point, it's a cookie. So there's always some form of food that we have to have in between us that we just kind of focus any nervous energy we're eating. So most of the time during the show, you'll see me with horns. Other episodes, I have no horns. These are actually really heavy. They're antler-based. It's like repurposed antlers. We actually picked them up at a Renaissance fair. I thought it was a great idea since I'm a tiefling. Like, hey, I'll have these horns. And then slowly but surely as the filming day goes on, they weigh, they shift, they move. And so I've come to the decision that if I wear them less and less, and that I'm going to start getting new ones, probably foam. Fickle Posse was chosen when my husband decided to make this bar where we were all going to meet. And he didn't know what to make unique about this bar in this world. He kept thinking and thinking, and he decided finally that he was going to focus on pickle juice. What they specialize in this world, pickles don't exist like they do in our world. So this is what she created, what she specialized in, the bartender. And when we were talking about, well, what do we call our group? We're just like, well, we met over pickle juice. Let's call it the Pickle Posse. And it started off as a joke, and then it slowly just kind of continued. And so that's how we became the Pickle Posse. I think what I loved about the bigger part of the adventures that we've had have probably been things that are more focused around our character building. The action's always fun, but it's always just action, like typical action. D&D games have those typical actions. I'm personally a fan of character building, interaction, diplomacy pieces, and so those had always been fun to me. The funnest thing that incorporated the character development and the action have been probably our recent one, where we ran into we had a fun Mad Max-style wagon chase in which we were able to explore what our characters were capable of doing and if we were able to think outside the box while still being our characters. And so that was a really big fun piece that I liked a lot. And it told a lot about the stories that we came from in the city, and then they kind of took us to the next chapter where we're going. Why I like the way that our dungeon master runs everything is probably he keeps us on our toes. He's very animated. He's very interactive with everything. He knows what he wants to do, does it. We're surprised by it, but then he also allows us to still keep our components of our characters and our real life selves in it. So if he knows that we're going to be humorous, he gives us the time to be humorous. If he knows that we're going to be serious, he knows how to get us to that serious point. There's a joke that he's probably made me or our cohort, Jordan, who plays Althea, cry because the story has been so in-depth and we never anticipated what was going to happen. And he's really good about not letting things slip. You would think with the relationship I have with him, something would leak about the story, but it never does. And that's the fun part about it. He just has a good balance of the humor, the storytelling, and how to bring everything that's good about us into the story. I think the reason we work really well together as a team is when some of us are actors. That was kind of what we started doing as our careers or hobbies. And I think we've known each other. In some way or form, all four of us have known each other, be it through acting pieces, be it through employment, even just having other games that we met through at our usual place that we game. That's how we met Jordan. Jordan's an artist, and she worked with me on some projects. Jesus, who played, not Jesus, that's our producer. Well, yeah, our producer, too. We met him at where we game all the time. Mark, our DM, leads gaming at the same place. Jose, we met through being a first-time member at a game, and so we realized these people are good. We get along each other. We have a history together. Let's see what happens, and it worked. We worked really well in that way. Coming from a theater background, recognizing that backstage crews, they're almost like gods. They get everything running. If it wasn't for their talents in being able to mix sound and their talents to record and the talents to coordinate the time to be in the studio, I don't think it'd be possible. They've been a big, big focal point to being able to do this. Had we not had the opportunity to know our producer, Jesus, and what he has access to, having a studio, having the ability and knowledge of the camera and how everything works, I don't think we'd even be able to do a basic, just the YouTube component by itself. I mean, you need the space, you need the talent, you need to know how to mix things, how to edit, how to even put fonts on the screen. Those are things that we as actors or just as individuals in our hobbies would never know how to do. And they help us keep going. I think even jokingly, they feed us. They keep us making sure that we're in a good mood. If we're not in a good mood, they find out ways to do it. And they're really great at what they do. They know how to, if it's a sound guy, he knows how to manage everything. They know how to get us at a certain way that they need in quality. And so I think that's, they're so important and so vital to all this. If someone has never heard about D&D and wanted to start, I would probably say online, believe it or not. And not in the traditional sense. When you say online, most people have like, well, we play Skype and we find groups on D&D Beyond. I would actually start personally on the imagination component and just role-playing. I think there's a lot of silly forums and fanfic writing and interactions between people that get them to think about creating characters and like, is this something they want to do? Because anyone can play any tabletop because there's instructions. D&D is just like any other game. They have instructions, you roll dice, you follow the numbers will give you details about what your character can do. But if you don't know how to role play, it's not fun. You're not developing a character, you don't know how to interact, you can't think out of the box about how to solve certain things, and that to me is part of the fun for D&D. So if you've never played it, what I would say is start role playing first and then find yourself a group that's willing to like, hey, I'm new at this, get me started. So I think people should watch Vicious Mockery because we're more down to earth and realistic. I think in other D&D games that are out there that are publicized on YouTube or in any of these channels, they tend to have some form of popularity link. Either they link to a voice actor or someone that's already popular for a different genre that doesn't tie into D&D. It's someone famous who just happens to like D&D and plays it. In our case, we're normal people. We have normal lives. We work. We strive to survive. And this is what you can be doing at home to the best of your ability. This is something that you should be involved in. It helps with socializing and just doing normal human interaction just in a fun, role-playing way. Why they should subscribe? I think people should subscribe to Vicious Mockery because without them, we wouldn't be doing this. I think if the more people we have that are counting on us to tell this story, the more energy and ambition for us to keep going and giving them what they want to see and what they enjoy and making them happy, that's how we thrive off of it.